Well, hi guys, welcome. My name is Robbie Carman. I am a colorist, is what I do, and all these guys are fabulous DPs. And a couple weeks ago, George asked me, hey, could you come down and moderate this panel? Because after all, I've worked with a lot of these guys. We do a lot of the same projects and that kind of stuff. And from my perspective, I jumped on the opportunity because all of these guys, I admire their work greatly. And I think they all kind of bring something different to the table in terms of understanding the technology about lensing and filming stuff, also about the creative stuff. And from my perspective as the moderator of this panel, I don't think that we could go on and on for hours and hours about codecs. You guys can find that information pretty much anywhere. I want to talk a little tech to start out, but then with these guys, I really want to get at the creative. That's what these guys do. They're creative masterminds in terms of framing and how they handle shoots, what goes into lighting, and all the various scenarios that they handle from the creative side. And, you know, if you're an aspiring shooter and you're doing a lot of shooting on your own, I think that's the part that I want you, hopefully you can glean the most from these guys for the literally from decades of experience of kind of how they approach shooting, how they approach the aesthetic of what they do. Because I know individually I've learned a lot from these guys over the years, and hopefully we can share some of that knowledge as well. So, first things first, guys, let's get the tech out of the way, right? Everybody wants to talk tech. NAB is coming up, of course. It's our annual Super Bowl of, you know, new cameras, new lenses, new workflows, that kind of stuff. I'm just going to put it to you. Let's go down the line. We'll start down here with Matt. Favorite camera and why?
Currently, I'm using the C300 Mark II. I'd say that's my primary camera at this point. Although I'm definitely a fan of the Red. Okay. Red Weapon, used that Red Dragon a couple times. Beautiful images pretty much out of any camera, but C300 Mark II at this point, big selling feature for that is the dual pixel autofocus. I use that a lot because a lot of times I don't usually have an AC, and you can pull off some stuff really easily that otherwise would be really difficult.
Cool. Okay. I like the Alexa, but you know, the Alexa is an $80,000 camera, so of course I like the Alexa. I own a C300 Mark II, and I own a C100. I love the look of those cameras, and I love how the image of those cameras looks naturally. A lot of people talk about codecs and how strong something is, if it's 444, 422, 421, whatever the hell, or 420. The cameras produce nice images, and that's what I'm looking at most of the time. You mentioned the dual pixel autofocus on the C300 Mark II. I had a chance to use that for the first time, and you know, I used to do a lot of sports, and I can imagine something like, you know, a simple dolly in or something like that, holding focus on that. It works beautifully, so I love that camera, and I'm glad I spent the $20,000
yeah,
on it.
Yeah, it's perfectly priced. I mean, it's a lot of bang for the buck.
Yeah,
this is the nice camera Mark II.
What's that?
C300
C300 Mark II.
And by the way, I did a poor job at moderating because I should have introduced Matt on this end, Kevin right here. I apologize.
Who are these?
And then I have Jim Ball next to me. Jim, what's your kind of camera du jour?
Well, I'll first say no favorites. I'm probably the odd man that's not a camera owner. That's a DP. I do have a C300, but I almost never use it because I'm always tailoring the cameras to the job. I mean, it's amazing how they've all kind of got their strong points and weak points, and always actually listening to what other people are doing and using them for to figure out if it solves a problem, you know, somewhere down the line, and finding an opportunity to use new technology, because I just don't have a preference. And you know, the thing is, the shelf life of these cameras is a couple of years. So from my perspective, it's not always the best investment. I have a garage full of stuff. I got a lot of gear, but not many cameras. I have other stuff that gets attached to the camera or makes the camera move or something
else. Support
gear,
yeah.
So I'm always looking. I'm always experimenting. I'm always looking up for opportunities for the right tool for the right job. Having said that, the latest flavor is Sony cameras, so that's what's being asked for.
Like the A7 series and stuff?
Yeah, all those cameras that sort of match pretty well. The A7, the FS7, and the F55, and then they got this little FS5 now that they get a camera stick in every little price point.
Well, it's Sony. They come out with a new camera every other week.
Right? Well, it's, you know, I will say this quickly about choosing cameras is that what I like is that the fact that they're less affordable and you could have more of them around allows you to you know, apply them to certain problems fairly quickly. So being able to have a couple cameras around allows you to pick one up, put one down, put, and stay within a budget. Mm. Mm-hmm. So I like that part about it, rather than having one big expensive one that, okay, you got to make it do all the jobs. So
gotcha.
It depends.
Peter?
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of a little bit like Jim. I always thought about having the lowest common denominator, so I've had a C300 for about 4 years. I will get a Scarlet Weapon, the Scarlet W, at some point in the next week or two. But really, I look at those cameras as like it sits on the shelf and it's always ready to go, but it's sort of the lowest common denominator. I can rent it at an easy price if someone doesn't really have a lot of money. And I kind of consider the C300 like a 5D now. And, you know, at that point, then it's really just whatever the project is, whatever the best application is. I don't want to be tied to one camera that's going to go out on every job. So, you know, I'm actually going to be shooting with an FS7 on Friday because that's kind of what the client was looking for in terms of the capabilities of that camera.
Sure.
And that was sort of what makes it fun, because at that point it's always like, all right, well, what's the best application for this? And of course, I do have an A7 R2 because of the same thing. I can just throw it on a gimbal and it's always there and it's always ready to go. And you can always just have it as a little extra. So,
cool. Thanks.
Excellent. I'm an old timer. I came up using film equipment that was created back in the 50s. upright moviolas. If anybody knows what one of those is, you could Google it. And Mitchell cameras that probably the design didn't change from certainly well pre-war. I still have a bunch of film cameras collecting dust. I still love not only the nuance of film, but part of what I think was central to my loving that whole workflow and way of working was the fact that it forced you to be disciplined.
Mm.
We're talking about how we keep shooting more and more terabytes of material, and you need a camera for this and a camera for that. And when I came up, because the price of film was what it was always something you thought about. There was, I think, a different way with a lot more energy up front before you actually hit the scene and just started rolling. And you simply couldn't afford to work the way people do now, which is just get off the plane, hit roll, and roll practically on everything until you get back on the plane to come home.
You start rolling, well, it's still in the case.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's cash.
Yeah.
It's doing a little pre-roll. Anyway, I am very fortunate in that I own what I think is one of the better cameras out there, the Arri Alexa. So I can, my go-to everyday camera, which people can't afford on nine jobs out of 10, I can say, well, I'll hook you up because it's sitting here anyway. Mm-hmm. So I'll upgrade you. And it's kind of funny when you have folks that aren't that on top of the technology, and they're like, no, it's got to be on a C300 or a C100.
Actually,
I haven't heard of this camera
right,
yet.
Right,
and then
right.
I just give it a little pregnant pause and go, it's the one they used to shoot Gravity?
Yeah.
Will
yeah,
that right. work for you? Yeah. Oh, okay, that should be okay.
So, you know, one of the things that I find interesting about camera technology is that, and you guys kind of all alluded to this, the fleeting kind of, you know, going from film to new cameras, there's always going to be something coming down the pike. And one of the adages that I always keep in mind, too, is the idea that, you know, cameras are going to come and go, but good glass is kind of for life, right? You know, we all know on the high end, you know, Master Primes and, you know, that kind of level lens. Jim, I'm curious if you would start us out, like, when it comes to this combination of camera body, lens, like, is the lens the more important factor overall?
I think it's really important. Yeah, I mean, from a performance, you know, in terms of the imaging it makes, but also from just operability and versatility. So it's still one of those things where you're, you know, depending on what kind of job you're doing, these days there are more choices, right? There's DSLR lenses, and then there's cinema lenses. There's vintage lenses, right? There's all this stuff, and you can sort of you know, tailor to, and the fact that cameras are so adaptable now that you can stick all of these lenses on all of the cameras. So you literally can, you know, make your decision based on price, based on what you own, based on how you want it to look. And there really is no limit to the options. So it's a good investment, right? Because you can use it everywhere. And it's a good investment because it'll be on the shelf for a long time making money. And it's also a great way to get all those little kind of kind of fringy lenses and needs that, you know, maybe you can afford the mainstream stuff, but in your personal kit, you can have all the little extras like tilt shifts and
big fisheye or something.
Fish eyes. You know, and you don't have to like order it for the second Tuesday and the third, you know, in March for that particular day. You can just have it around, right? So when you get inspired, oh, this would be a really good shot with this lens. Oh, I have that right here. So good long-term investment, good performance, and I have a lot of them.
So Matt, I'm curious, you know, doing a lot of projects around town, do you find yourself purchasing more lenses, you know, whether they be photo style lenses or cinema style lenses, or are you going and renting them locally or wherever you happen to be so you can get, you know, because you're probably not going to buy a set of, you know, Master Brimes or whatever, right?
No.
How do you go about that? Is this something that you invest in, or is it something that you look as, you know, just another rental item depending on the production?
So the way I've looked at it for the past couple of years is I have invested in glass that I feel will benefit me long term for probably 80 to 90% of my client base. So I have a set of EF lenses that I use most of the time, and then I recently purchased a set of the Canon Cinema Primes, which I've used for some more high-end stuff, and I've been getting demand for that recently. But I do rent when the job calls for it, because what I like to do is I like to examine what the project is going to be, and in certain cases, like I work with a producer who likes to shoot interviews with zooms because he likes to reframe real quickly.
Sure.
And so you want the ability to just change the shot and get that. Other clients I have really want a look of a prime. A lot of times if I'm shooting handheld B-roll, that kind of stuff, I'm going to be using EF glass with, say, the dual pixel autofocus or something like that. So I have a set of base lenses that covers, like I said, 80 to 90% of what I do. And I find I've had that for several years, and that's already started to, you know, the investment has paid off. And the Cinema Primes, I figure that's going to be, you know, a long-term investment that will then pay off in the long term.
Sure. Now, Dennis, I'm curious, because of your film background, and you probably used quite a few different lenses over the years. You know, one of the things that I find from a grading perspective as I'm working with footage is that I definitely have clients that are always asking for kind of a specific look. And when I try to explain to them that, like, hey, that look is not necessarily something that we're engineering in post, but that look is something that is the front end of the camera, do you try to match kind of your client's aesthetic? Does that influence your lens choice? So if somebody wants kind of the Cook look or, you know, the Zeiss look, do you think about that, or is that, you know, kind of something that is kind of goes by the wayside?
No, the more discriminating clients will get that granular. Most don't, unfortunately. And now that everybody is shooting in a log mode, you have so much latitude, as you know,
sure,
from your expertise as
yep.
a colorist. But it used to come up a whole lot more in film. You know, the Zeiss had a specific cooler, bluer type
more
of a
precise
look.
Precise kind of look, yeah.
Cooks have never been as hyper sharp as the Master Primes, which is a reason a lot of DPs prefer that. It's a slightly more nuanced fall off out of critical focus.
Yep.
And when you're shooting portraits and people who have flaws, and now you have these cameras with extraordinary resolution, that can be a little bit more forgiving. But for the wow factor, sometimes you want that insane resolution of the Master Primes. You know, in terms of our own inventory, we have Primes, Zeiss zooms, Red short zooms, lots of Nikon glass, converted 150 to 600 old Cine, lenses, so a whole lot of different options.
Cool. Now, you had mentioned this idea of people shooting in log, and this is something that I think if we walked in this room a couple years ago even, right, and we said to people, oh, we're shooting raw, they might have understood that from photography background. I'm sure a lot of you have shot raw photos, right? But this concept of log is, how many people are currently shooting log? Anybody? Yeah? Okay. So I'm curious about this, Kevin, because we've had some kind of offline discussions about log and log workflow. And, you know, from my perspective, I'm often dealing with clients, and I would say the bulk of the receivable materials I get these days is log. And just, you know, again, the benefit of log, of course, is the ability to preserve shadow detail, highlight detail, and then set contrast, et cetera, in post. Now that your cameras, more and more cameras are shooting log, and you're on set with clients and you're on set with people, have you ever had the experience where a client walks up to you, takes a look at the viewfinder maybe, or looks at the client monitor and goes, we're paying all this money for that? right? Because it doesn't look very good coming out of the camera.
About a week ago. I do a lot of shoots with high-end CEOs.
Okay.
And one of them is very, very discerning, and you know, and especially when it comes to glass. Like we shoot her with Cook lenses.
Okay.
Because she knows the difference. You know, all of the light. You know, she doesn't want the photo flow from China. She knows. She actually knows what a Kino flow is. Getting back to log, yeah, I think when I do that shoot, I have to specifically make sure in with the understanding that if they see that flat image, they're not going to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is, if I put too much contrast in it, they're so discerning about shadows under the eyes, shadows under the chin, that they'll go nuts on me. So I actually have to sit there with the monitor and the contrast. I'm like, and split the difference with them.
Right. Okay. Now, Peter, related, like, so, like, do you find that new methods of recording, right? Whether it be log, whether it be raw. Has that added a level of complexity to your shooting work, whether it be just from monitoring on set, right? Whether it be to explaining to a client, whether it just be to, like, figuring out exposure, right? You know, like, have these recording technologies made your life more difficult, or have they helped?
I mean, it makes it better in the sense that you get typically more of the dynamic range out of the camera, but in terms of keeping track of post-workflow, keeping track of monitoring on set, no, it's a nightmare. It's actually really hard. And you start getting things where you get double LUTing coming out of a camera because someone changed a setting or burned in LUTs on media that's, you know, someone makes a change and it's like, oh, I want to see a LUT as a lookup table, which allows you to see log. It takes log and adds sort of what a basic...
Normalizes
a little bit, basic contrast and color. So it looks like what you would expect it to look like when it's finished. Exposure, sort of looking at where it's supposed to be in the waveform, or using false color systems and dialing in the controls on the false coloring and that sort of thing. In some ways, once you master all that, it becomes really granular and really easy to keep track of all those things. But you do have to have a pretty deep dive and knowing what C-Log does versus S-Log 2 versus S-Log 3, which is like Canon. It's two versions of Sony. Versus the RE log.
Three versions of Sony now. So that's S-Log 3.
The Alexa look.
Right,
and
Canon and Canon
9A.
And then there's a C-Log 2.
C-Log 2.
So, like, so I guess that's a leading way of asking all of you that, you know, it used to be, I think, that whether you went out with the film stock that you chose and you exposed that film stock, or you went out with whatever video camera you were, has this added, like, do you think the benefits of shooting raw log, you know, in these formats have made you get better images, or has that just made it more complex for everything that you do?
I think it depends on the workflow.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think it depends on what's being done on the post side.
Because
that's one of the conversations I have with a lot of my clients aren't quite as educated when it comes to the log and things. Yeah,
today.
So that's one of the things I always ask is, you know, what do you want me to deliver?
Right.
And so a lot of times in, for example, with the Canon, I'm shooting in either just straight Rec 709 because they want something that they don't have to grade. And unfortunately, a lot of the clients I work with don't have the budget for any color correction, or they and which
I
know you
lot,
it hurts
lot,
right
yeah.
So or I shoot in like the wide dynamic range,
sure.
and so because it pains me when I hand over log and then I see the edit and they've done no grade at all. And so one of the things I use and when I'm on set, I have an Odyssey attached to my camera almost all the time, even if not recording to it, because I have a whole mess load of LUTs built into it, and I'm always sending the client monitor a LUTed image, so that, you know, because otherwise I end up having that conversation.
Yeah.
Why does it look the way it is? So,
I
think it really depends on the workflow. And that's why I always try and have that conversation ahead of time with the client and say, what are you doing with it in post? You know, are you going to be grading this? You know, doing what? And a lot of times when they say grade, that's when I say, okay, you're going to want it in Rec 709.
Sure.
So,
right.
Got it. What do you think, Kev?
Well, I think, I mean, a couple of things. I have clients, some of which don't care because they don't know the difference. And they also have a timetable that won't...
They're depending on you for that expertise.
Yeah, they,
right.
they can't. They don't use DaVinci Resolve. They don't understand grading. I mean, I made the mistake about 3 years ago of thinking that if I'm shooting in a studio where I have a controlled environment where I can control every single exposure point on the meter, that I don't need to shoot log. And that was maybe about 3 years ago, but I did a test that finally changed my mind, where they literally showed me studio shot on a white Seik in 709, straight from the camera, graded image on the right, and the graded image was better. I mean, it was just a better, it was sharper, sure. And it had better contrast, and it had, it as far as I could tell, it had less noise. So at this point, I try to steer clients to shooting raw for everything, log for everything, you know, if they can, yeah, because I think it's a better image, if they know what to do with it.
Can we stop and talk about
it? I'd like to jump in and
ask
a question on
that. Well, can we just take a step back and just say what Rec. 709 is?
Yeah, of course. So Rec. 709, and you guys please feel free to chime in as well. Rec. 709 is basically HD color space. This is a SMPTE-derived decision from numerous years ago about, hey, this is the color gamut. Interestingly enough, Rec. 709 doesn't say actually anything about gamma of an image. So that's a little bit of a subjective thing, whether it's 2.2, 2.4, et cetera. But that's HD color space. Other common color spaces that we're going to find, P3 for digital cinema release, Rec. 2020, which is an emerging standard, very wide gamut, almost the entire human visual locus, like all the light we can see. Then, of course, on the computer side, we have sRGB and those kind of things. But for the most part, we're doing things in, for delivery purposes in Rec. 709. A log encoded image, if you want the Jeopardy fact, log encoded image came back from when Dennis was talking about film early on when people were scanning film in a telecine. The timers at the time realized that they didn't have the push and pull of that film that they did on a videotape, that they did in a photochemical way, right? So some very smart people at Kodak got together and they developed what's called the Cineon encoding system. That's where we got things like DPX files and that kind of stuff. And that's where modern log has kind of come from. So log is a way of encoding that signal, but as you guys have all pointed out, most of the time it's kind of translated translated, I guess, to Rec. 709 or another common color space. So,
what's your name?
Kevin.
So kind of just hearing what Matt and Kevin said, both kind of their situations, I find that a lot of people are shooting in 8-bit.
Sure.
I find hearing, I agree with what Matt says a lot about clients that won't color correct something. And it's like, so, and then kind of going back to what Dennis says, I kind of subscribe to the old school of trying to make it look right in camera. Like just making everything look right in camera, especially with 8-bit. If you're shooting on 8-bit, I kind of disagree with what you said in 8-bit color space. I mean, there's no doubt beyond that you can get that log back and make it look better. But when you're compressing it as much as 8-bit, so my question is to you, because when I look at it, I feel that if you nail the 8-bit, it looks better than taking the log and moving it back. And that's been my experience. But I wouldn't be shooting quite a 709. I would be shooting something a little more neutral, kind of a self-concoction.
Yeah, lessening contrast, lessening sharpness.
Yeah, lessening those things to kind of make sure I have it over there. But my question is, what is your thought on that? As a color corrections, I feel like once you go beyond 8-bit, you're fine. I think you got all the...
I can sum up my feelings on that really easily, right? Is that the idea of bake it in, develop the look and set? Yeah, of course. I'm sure these guys would agree. Nobody's advocating that, like, hey, you're shooting log, you're shooting raw. Like, we don't need lights. We don't need any of that. I mean, nobody's advocating that. But my point of view of it is that what seemed correct in the creative decisions that go in on set, they always change, right? So that idea of sort of baking in kind of, the log, from a raw standpoint, truly baking that stuff in, or log giving you more flexibility, is that I prefer to work with those formats simply from a creative flexibility standpoint. It might be that I end up exactly back at what you had on set and the way that you looked at it on your monitor. That happens all the time, right? But it might be that I create something that's totally different, right? So from a workflow standpoint, I prefer the flexibility of those images. But I think that there is certain thing that there's not black or white. I think that having worked with a lot of these guys, I think that they will all agree that there is a certain level of nailing it in camera, right? And then there's a certain level of leaving it up for interpretation later in post-production, right? So controlling shadows, controlling highlights, controlling color casts, and all that kind of stuff is something that these guys, and we'll get into the creative side of this in just a second, is something that these guys do extremely well. But then giving a colorist the greater flexibility to reshape that light or reshape those colors later on is an important thing too.
If I can add one thing, Robbie, the only thing is, it's objective that you have a greater latitude to make creative decisions after the fact when you shoot in log or raw.
Yeah.
That's not open to interpretation. But one of the things that's a downside of shooting logs is when your client thinks they're a colorist.
Totally.
But
I get it.
They're not.
Believe me, I get
and
it all the time.
I've gotten back footage where I just wished I had shot Rec 709 deliberately to bake in a better look than they end up with, according to my own aesthetic.
Of course.
At that point, it's not up to me, unfortunately.
Of
but
course.
And you see stuff make it to air that I am convinced you have some bonehead at the agency who sees the ungraded image. And in his infinite wisdom goes, I like that look. I like that look. And you're like,
you see it
on TV. That's not a look.
It's a look
that
now.
It is now, yeah.
So
I've been asked for that look.
I would agree with you totally, wholeheartedly, and I'm sure you guys have maybe experienced this on your own land. I was actually working on some political grade, say, some political spots.
Oh, Jesus.
And it was shot Alexa. And I'm going in, just doing my thing, adding a little contrast, a little saturation. And it was like nothing but, I was supervised session, right? Client's like, no, it's too much. I literally just did, you know, node reset and resolve back to the original image, and it was like, that's it. Right? And I think one of the dangers that I face is that people get, at least in the editorial phase, they get used to the look of low contrast flat image, so that once you start doing what you're supposed to be doing with it, grading it and doing things, it becomes weird, right? And people, and then it is subject to a little more interpretation. So, no, that's an interesting perspective. Yeah.
So, one thing I'm not sure about is how many of the people sitting up there, listen, excluding you,
yes,
actually do editing as well. Or
that's a good question.
Compared to
good question.
Take capturing the image and then passing it off.
Totally, great question.
So, I'm more interested in when you pass it off and you're in log, how many of the people that you end up giving the material to understand what was supposed to make it look like,
right,
and how close you think the projects end up.
So that's a great question, guys. When it comes to the deliverables, because, I mean, I know a lot of you are working with production houses or agencies or whatever. And you guys, I think both of you guys kind of alluded to this, to having that discussion with the client. But from a true handoff standpoint of view, what are you doing most of the time? Like, Jim, like when you go out and shoot something for, you know, National Geographic or whatever, is that out of your control? You're just kind of rolling the camera and then they take it from there? Or are you delivering something in a purposeful way?
I'm involved in a lot of projects that go for long periods of time, and sometimes there's a lot of different people shooting them, working on them, and sometimes I'm sort of the coordinator of that. So from my perspective, log is like the baseline where I know when they get into edit a year later or whatever and they're trying to make decisions, if some renegade Cameron goes, oh, I like this look, he's out. I get rid of him right away because it's a collaboration, and log is a great way to have that baseline, so when the decisions are made, and sometimes I'm involved in the decisions early, sometimes it's about, okay, what's the post house or who's the color,
right,
how far, you know, I have those conversations, but I am handing it off, and it's not really, I mean, for a lot of those like documentaries and a lot of those sort of long series things, you know, it's there's a discussion, but usually nobody knows what they want, so you certainly aren't going to make a decision on a look
ahead of time.
It's just I've seen it change too many times. I've seen people make different decisions over the months. So it's kind of like film was. You know, you deliver. My job would be to deliver a solid digital
negative.
I know in log, depending on which camera, you know what the headroom is from 18% gray to highlight, what the shadow is, whether it's S-Log 2, S-Log 3, I know where I need to be, where the information needs to be, so when they start playing around, they're gonna have so much flexibility that they're gonna be able to get something they really like.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if they go ahead and don't grade it later, that doesn't happen, that doesn't seem to happen very often, but that's on them. I mean, I'm not,
sure,
I did my job. So I'm a handoff guy, but I'm not an editor. I get involved in these projects, I go on to the next one, I follow them through. Sometimes they invite me to the color correct. More often than not these days, I get the notes, I send notes. You know, it's a courtesy almost, it's not, I'm not getting paid for it. But if they value, you know, if they value how the thing's going to look in the end, it'd be kind of silly not to consult me. I mean, most of the time they don't. I'm not saying that I'm like this, you know, essential personnel at the post phase. But I know a lot of the colorists, and I know a lot of the people on some of the things I'm involved with, you know, at Discovery and Nat Geo and stuff. So I know, I go, we're in good hands. They know what I do. And I usually generate a lot of notes from shoot days to go, here's when I was in Cine EI mode, and then I put it in a custom mode because I was in some sick fluorescent lights and I wanted to be able to white balance and have some control. Then when we went back outside, I switched it back. You know, so I'll give them lots of notes, and the editors and the post people love that stuff. So I try to maintain communication because, you know, just giving that flat image or something is, I mean, they'll figure it out, but why not collaborate as much as you can? So that's what handing off is involved
to. Yeah, so I was going to say, because I do a lot of my own editing. So a lot of the stuff that I shoot, about 50% of what I shoot, I end up editing myself. So in that case, I since I know when I'm shooting it, so it goes back to what Dennis said, like, you know, Dennis, you had mentioned about, you know, kind of controlling yourself when you shoot and not having, like, diary of the camera, as I like to say. I follow that because I know I'm going to be editing it. So I don't, you know, and I know how much time I have in post, so I don't want to be going through thousands of hours when I don't have to. So if I know I'm shooting it, then I'm going to be editing with it. I kind of look at it from the editor's perspective. And I also do that to some extent when I'm handing it off to clients, because I edit, I know what you need from an editor's perspective. So when I'm on a shoot, I know what coverage I need, I know what coverage I don't need. And that way the editors are a little bit happy. But the notes are really good. You know, I try and do that a little bit. And, you know, even just putting up a chart when you change colors or change lighting setups, that helps.
I found out later that they almost never use those.
Yeah, unless I mean, it depends on the editor. Actually, I mean, I work with Mike's over there. And
pretty good about doing
Mike's
that.
Editing some of the stuff I shot for Sapling right now. And we had a discussion. Yeah, so we had a discussion beforehand about what we were going to shoot and, you know, how we were going to shoot it, and gave him some notes. And so it was good because we could at least chat post-talk a little bit before we went on the shoot.
We got a question in the back.
Yeah, it's kind of linked to what you were talking about already. So I am an editor and occasionally have to color correct when people can't afford Robbie. And so
I work cheap.
Well, two things. It's kind of, one is the question is, I can't tell you how often I get a producer will bring me in a drive with media on it, and they'll give it to me and it's shot log, and I don't even know the camera. I don't know what they were thinking. You know how you're saying you have a lot of scene, you've got some lots of fines, so that you can get an idea of the kind of look you want. But I'd love to hear, when I get the footage, what you were thinking, because it gives me a place to start, right? It gives me a place to look at and see what you were thinking and maybe some of the creative decisions you made, which leads me into my next question. And this may just, I hope this isn't sensitive, but I have a friend who's a DP who hates shooting log because he feels really reduced in his creative decisions about how things should look, he feels reduced in his role, as if some of his expertise of what will look good and what is, you know, going to be attractive and look great has been removed. I'm interested if that's an effect for you guys.
Yeah, that's a great question. What do you think, Kev?
The technology doesn't change the process. I mean, it doesn't change. You still have lights, you still have actors, you still have producers, directors, and a light meter. Cameras 10 years ago are like piston driven engines. We're on turbines now. And that's the difference between log and straight up 709, in my opinion. I mean, more dynamic range is good for me. More information and more wiggle room is good for him. So I think it's good for everybody, in my opinion.
I think the question is a little bit more like high level and less technical.
Yeah.
And this is sort of where I was kind of maybe hoping we could step back to.
Sure.
To some degree, is that there is a lot of discussions at various levels about the ownership of the image.
Of course.
And what you bring to it. There's a difference between like slamming in and like lighting an interview and doing that, and that's just a lot of that you see.
Yep.
But actually lighting a true scene and actually getting something that might have some sort of motivation and having some framing to it, and the size of the frame.
Yep.
That sort of element does become an issue, and it's becoming an increasing issue in terms of what you're doing and why, and then you go and see it later, and then you see what someone has done to it. We're ultimately servants of the client to some degree, or servants of that idea, so you're always doing your best in that way. It would be great to create a couple style frames or go into Photoshop and just do a JPEG and say, this is what that's looking like. but you know, you don't get necessarily asked to, and there is that element of being reduced, but that's sort of the job, so you sort of, and that's the way it is in a lot of these places, is you want to do your best work, but there's always limitations. You see the limitations with the budget, or time, or location, or whatever it is, and color correction. So, you know, you always try to do your best, but from a high-level perspective, like, there are DPs who make a lot more money than all of us combined on a daily basis, are having this conversation all the time, because
sure.
it's the ownership of the image has become, you know, when it was film, there was a certain amount of, like, 20 to 22 stops of push-pull or whatever, but, like, now, with RAW and whatever, you can be, you know, I was talking to a BBC crew, and they were like, yeah, we shot something, and then we sent it off, and this colorist just decided to move the key,
mm-hmm.
which is, like, crazy. Like, that shouldn't happen. Like, that shouldn't be even possible, technically, but, like, it, I mean, I guess it is, but, like, you know, they just, and they short-sided the key. They moved the key to the short side. It's like, to me, I'm like, sweet Jesus, no.
All right. That sucks.
Yeah, and so it's happening now, where even the colorist is doing stuff that is just weird. And so there is a concern about it, but it's also just the nature of the market.
And I would just mention one quick technical thing, which is that one of the nice features of some of the better monitors coming out is that you don't even have to load a fancy LUT in them. Rec. 709, since that's an agreed upon standard, you can just engage so the client doesn't look at a washed out log image that makes somebody who doesn't deal with it on a daily basis nervous.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you can shoot log, explain to them, see how nice it looks on the screen, you can take it even further than this, but we're shooting in this other mode, and then you show them the log image and say, this is what you're gonna see until your editor or your colorist dives into it. Right?
I've taken the step of actually sending LUTs to editors that I've had loaded in my Odyssey, so that if I know that they're gonna be editing it, and I had the LUT on the Odyssey on set, I've actually sent them that LUT and said, load this into Premiere, you'll get it to look exactly like we had it on set, and then you can go from there.
Sure.
So, I mean, my perspective on the ownership of the image is kind of like, yeah, that'd be nice, but you know, ultimately it's kind of like, it's out of my hands once they get into post. So
I agree. I think it's about communication and talking to them. I'm sorry, I don't know your name, but to our editor back here, I think in the best case scenario, there's simply a discussion up front. And I totally understand your DP sensitivity to losing some of that control. But I think the better solution is to talk to the client, express how I've invested X number of years of my life at this craft, which I take very seriously, and I'm really hoping that you take what I give you, which is a collaboration, and take it as far as it can go, rather than have a separate agenda. And likewise, I don't have a separate agenda. I want to know what you want, so that you end up kind of working together.
From the editor's from this editor's perspective, I'm always curious to see what you wanted, what you were thinking, even if that's not
me
how
too.
It ends up.
Yeah,
I'm curious to know, and that's why I would love it.
It depends on, you know, when I'm editing footage, a lot of times, like, I've edited stuff that Peter shoots, and a lot of times I don't do a whole lot to it because it looks great other than basic, you know, if it's log, you know, then I'll just grade it, you know, to get it back to what I think it looks like or things like that. A lot of times, you know, I just end up looking at the image and, you know, try and bring it to what I think it needs to be. Like, if I'm editing, you know, and I don't know what the camera is and I can't find out who it is, then I start getting creative and I start, okay, well, if I can't get information about this, then I'm going to make this the best I can. And if I don't have time to do that, then I'm going to just slap a LUT on in Premiere, you know, kind of do two tweaks and then call it done if I have to get it out the door. So that's just the nature of having to work within certain parameters. It's just, what can you make? Can you make the best image given the parameters you have, in the budget you have, in the time you have? That's the greatest creative challenge there is. And that's what we all thrive on, in theory.
Well, and also, you know, I think everybody here would agree that every client is different. Like, they all want to work in different ways. So if a client says to me, you know, I'd rather just, it looks fabulous in camera, and we just throw it in there and it's done, I don't have a problem with that at all.
I do that a lot.
100% of my clients, they all want the image to be beautiful. I mean, that's at the end of the day, that's, I'm not going to get hired if that doesn't happen.
Yeah. I would say, like, I edit and produce, and so I would say it depends on the project. So, like, I just shot something in S-Log because I wanted it to look really, really good, and we have the budget, and we can go grade it.
Sure.
But we also just shot like 3 vignettes in a day, and we
got turn around quick, right?
Yeah. Turn around, and so I graded it in Avid because I knew I didn't have the budget or the
of course,
yeah. or you know something that have 2 cameras, and I want to make sure that they both, even though they're the same camera, they look the same. Their settings are the same. Then I'll don't mess up. So in a way, I think it also depends on the project as well as the client.
Timing, all that stuff. Yeah,
yeah,
I agree.
That's good. That influences my decision.
Absolutely. That's a great point. Now, guys, I have one last technical question that I want to move on to what I really want to talk with you guys about, sort of the aesthetic and some of the kind of creative decisions that really interest me. But I would be remiss if I didn't mention this one thing because it's on everybody's minds these days, and that is the idea of, you know, UHD 4K plus resolutions, right? You know, I would say that half the projects that I get these days, probably about 40% of the projects that I get, are originating, at least originating UHD, right? Even though they might still edit in a 1080 timeline, that kind of stuff. And I'm curious from a DP's perspective, you know, there's the idea of more pixels, right? Better, higher resolution. And then there's the idea of better pixels, right? You know, that we're seeing with developments like HDR and Rec 2020 and these kind of stuff. How does this whole UHD 4K game impact the creative work that you're doing now? What do you think,
Jay? I'd say, 90% of what I'm doing is required to be originated in 4K. So for the most part, it hasn't changed my workflow very much. I mean, the cameras, a lot of the cameras are, you know, the same cameras. Mm. I mean, you pretty much, the big change over was going to bigger sensor cameras. That's when things got heavier. But the 4K thing, you know, there's people that have to deal with the media down the line, but I don't, so I'm like, fine. Some situations I've been in where, depending on the camera, like that Varicam, we shot a big project, Discovery required that camera in 4K, and it was a big camera, and the flange distance on the lens mount required that I had to use big, I couldn't use any of all, when I said before, all the lenses you could use them, not in that camera. So it hugely limited what I could do. I had to put this huge camera on my Steadicam instead of something small. You know, it was all these things, but that was a rare occasion. Most of the time, the 4K thing has not been an issue. And I mean, from a practicality point of view, I think it's a waste because it's not, to me, right? It's not about resolution, it's about color space and dynamic.
Yeah, that's what
range.
I meant by better pixels versus
yeah, so
more
it's
pixels.
Like they're misguided, but the market is determining this and it's not going to change.
Right.
So I'm like, fine, you know. And, you know, I don't know, we get on some of these shows where it seems to make sense. Like I occasionally operate in that House of Cards show, and I talk about reducing your job. You really just sit there and there's this huge frame and you don't really do anything with it. And
is that the idea because later on
they're
somebody's
just
going to
reframe the frame later?
Okay.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
It's but you know, that's that. But the bigger thing is the data stream, the broadcast stream that this stuff is going to get out to your TV or whatever is so teeny that it's
really
like
matter,
it's
yeah.
illogical. But from my working point of view, I'm like, yeah, fine.
Peter, Kevin, do you guys, are you facing a lot of requests for UHD and 4K, or is this not something that you're facing often?
I mean, all the doc stuff that I've been shooting has still all been 1080p.
Okay.
So, I mean, there's a lot of that that's out there, and it's still a very viable frame. And, you know, I mean, I think that from a technical or aesthetic perspective, I mean, it's always been, the eye always sees contrast. It doesn't see resolution. It gets all this information from other stuff. I mean, the good thing about it is that, you know, if you go to, you know, Dennis's film thing, I mean, it's always, you've always been down-resing.
Sure.
And there's always a nice aesthetic that comes from that. So shooting a bigger frame and down-resing is nice, but then, of course, you get into the, you know, the reframing elements that become strange. But
what do you think?
I think it's now starting to really come around. Like, I think clients, I mean, part of the reason why I bought a new camera is because clients had started requesting 4K, and I didn't own a 4K camera, and I was sick of renting. So I think that it's starting to happen. I think you just mentioned, you know, 4K is not necessarily good for people. You know, if you do a close up on a person right there and they have lots of features of their face that they don't want to show, 4K is not a way to do it. But then again, that's where lenses come in. So, I mean,
Dennis, what do you think?
I just recently bought a new camera to answer the 4K demand, and I think I was telling Chris, it's the first, I've been in the business now for 34 years, and it is absolutely the only time in that time span that the new camera I bought was inferior to what I'd been using. Up until then, my Alexa, which at this point is probably 5-year-old technology, would you say about
it?
I think still has the best pixels, and it's, there's no right or wrong on this stuff, it's objective.
Sure.
But a lot of the A-list DPs that I have immense respect for tend to agree with me, you know, the Roger Deakins of the world and all these hyper-talented guys. So I had to go out and drop another whatever on a new camera that shoots, you know, all this, all these extra pixels, but at the end of the day, it doesn't improve the product. And I can't think of any job where I would go to that camera if the client didn't dictate that they have those additional pixels.
Very interesting. The irony of that is that, so the Arri Alexa has been around for a long time, and there's a lot of films that get shot on it. There's a lot of TV shows that get shot on it. And it's like, oh, pay $18 to see IMAX. Well, guess what, guys? You're going to a 4K projection, and it was shot on a 2K camera.
Right.
You're going to it for 5 years.
Right.
And now, but the thing is, the clients get what they want, and they ask for what they want, and they get it in their head that they need a particular camera or a particular file size, and that's just sort of the way it is.
Well, in talking of resolution, you know, Avatar was shot at 1080p.
Sure.
I saw that on a 90-foot screen, and it looked fine to me.
Yeah,
so
I was going to say that 4K, I have a little bit different perspective on the 4K because I do a lot of motion graphics work. So from a motion graphics perspective, the 4K is great because, you know, you're always, because now if I'm finishing in 1080, which most of my stuff is, I have the ability to do a digital reframe and kind of, you know, fly through things and get close to people when you could never do that in 1080. I mean, even if you now, if you turn a 4K camera vertically and shoot, you know, shoot a full body, you have, you have all this real estate to work with. So, you know, from a motion graphics perspective, 4K is fantastic. You know, you just have to deal with the data rates and everything that comes with it. So a lot of the applications that I've been getting requests for are for 4K green screen.
Mm-hmm.
And we had this discussion real quickly beforehand, is that, you know, a lot of clients, you know, they want 4K green screen because they want two camera angles. They want the wide, and then they just cut in. Now, that poses some creative and philosophical problems that people may have, but I get it. When you're, you know, crunched on a budget and, you know, you're paying for one camera and getting two camera angles, it's not really angles, but, you know, to the client, they, you know, they get more options. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, 4K green screen is just, it's a dream to work with.
That's interesting perspective. Now, I want to change it up just real quick, guys, because, you know, this techno stuff is good, but, like, the thing that I admire about all of you guys is what's up here, right? The eye, the aesthetic that goes into this. I can pick up a camera, right? I can turn a camera on. I can hit record. But, like, I have nowhere near the ability to get the shots that you guys get. So I'm curious, like, you know, if you could get, maybe this is dumbing it down too much, but, like, you know, I feel like I could be a camera operator. Does that make sense? Right, I can push the buttons and I technically know what aperture is and shutter speed and that kind of stuff. In your mind, what is that distinction between being a, you know, capable operator and that next level of being a director of photography and really mastering that craft? Like, is there a time in your life where you feel like you made that switch, or is it just an ongoing process where you're constantly, you know, developing that craft and learning more and more about your aesthetic? What do you think?
I mean, I can tell you that the way I look at it is that when I go into a room and my client is, you know, what are we going to do? My ability is to give them options. Is that I can walk into the room, look around, and start to see different shots. You know, if it's an interview, okay, you know, set up here, set up there. What are the advantages? What are the disadvantages? And I think that's what the clients that I work with are looking for. They're looking for somebody who can provide a creative eye. Whereas somebody else may just walk into the room and say, where do you want me to set up?
Sure.
They bring me into the room and I say, okay, based on what we need to accomplish here, this is the best way to accomplish that story. Or this is, or planning out a shot, drawing a lighting diagram, working with the creative team beforehand to kind of assess what we need to get. Even having something as simple as just having a shot list, you know, and being able to go to the client and be like, okay, here's the coverage we need to get today, you know, if you're not provided that. I think that's the distinction in my mind.
Okay. Kevin, what do you think your distinction there is? I mean, do you,
what
do
you just said.
Okay, I mean, do, but do you...
Lighting.
Do you, yeah, that's the question. Like, the thing that I admire about all you guys, and I've worked with Kevin and Jim probably the most out of this group, is that, like, I'm always amazed by the lighting capabilities and how you guys can shape, and all of you can shape light in the moment on set by using, whether they be practical instruments, whether they be, you know, lights that you bring in, how you, you know, put a scrim over something. Like, besides the actual lensing and shooting of something, how hard do you work at that part of the game, right? Like, the sort of the gaffing, light shaping, light design part of the work that you do.
Well, Jim was talking about lenses before as an aesthetic choice. My thing is lights. I think lights are a much better investment, because the more lights you have, the more options you have, you know, or, you know, the difference between a one-ton truck and a two-ton truck on a shoot. I think good lighting is good cinematography. And I think framing comes last, but, you know, I think it's lights, camera, action. You know, there's a reason why lights are first. I think lighting. I mean, you give the world's greatest camera to somebody who doesn't know how to light, it's still going to look like shit, you know?
I love working with gaffers.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're the best. I work with some great...
You gotta tell them what to do, though.
Yeah, but a lot of times I ask for their creative input, because sometimes they've, you know, they've been in a lot of situations that I might not have been in, and, you know, I go say, this is what I'm thinking,
yeah,
you know, and then they can give me the options.
And
so, yeah, and that's what I really enjoy, that collaborative process. Because, you know, when I'm on a set and I have to do all the lighting and, you know, set up multiple cameras and sometimes even set up audio, you end up kind of doing everything kind of mediocre. And you're not really focusing on one thing, which in my case should be the camera. Okay. So that's why I love working with other creatives in this, because I can just kind of tell them what I'm thinking and then they kind of just make it happen. So
fair enough. Dennis, what do you think?
I tend to be very, very hands-on with the lighting, and early in my career, I would love working with the talented gaffers that had a lot more time on set than I did, but at this point, I'm kind of like an old dog, not really that keen on new tricks unless I'm in a novel situation.
Yeah.
So I'm using people that are more executing. I don't think that's even hot. Sorry. So I'm using people that tend to execute rather than get particularly creative with me, because I do have my very, very, very particular about my style. Mm-hmm. And again, I came up shooting film, so it's always with meters and I think in tenths of an f-stop. So when I'm adjusting things, which is now really easy with dimmable HMIs and LEDs that give you extraordinary control, very fine, used to have to put wire in front of the lights, which is kind of crude. It's working in half or full stop increments. Mm-hmm. Now you can, you know, knock 2% off of a particular light. So lighting is everything, I think. And just one little shout out to interviews. I think a lot of times they're considered the bastard stepchild of a show.
It takes a lot of work to light.
And
yeah.
I don't like the editor to feel a need to cover my talking heads. I like the talking heads to be absolutely gorgeous portraits.
Right.
I ask for 3 hours to set a typical interview, and a lot of times it's not going to happen, and budget and what other you know, aspects of the shoot are going to not allow. But sometimes you have one interview on Capitol Hill with whoever's coming to, and they give you the room, so
go,
why not?
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Take it as far as you can, and other times you've got to do the best you can in whatever the time frame you have. But given the time, I will bring 3 Magliners worth of
mm-hmm.
lighting and grip equipment and ask for 3 hours for an interview.
Peter, what's your approach to lighting? Are you methodical about it? Or do you
absolutely?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's different for every job and everything. So I mean, with interviews. I mean, I've been experimenting a lot with making things actually smaller.
Yeah.
Because to me, you know, some of this new technology, but not all of it's very good, so there's been a lot of testing with that.
Yeah.
You know, I've been working with a lot of remote phosphor technology now, because it's just like, you know, power requirements are an issue and space requirements are an issue, and then you got to put a 4x frame with which diffusion in front of it, whereas now with some of the stuff, it's really soft to begin with, and you can diffuse it again, and you get soft on soft, but it only takes a small footprint. You don't need a generator. So for me, I've been trying to come up from the smallest footprint possible to get the best amount of effect.
Mm.
So that's kind of like the initial start to everything that I do. And then, you know, when the options arise, it gets bigger. I mean, in terms of like an approach overall, it comes down to sort of intent and framing and actually still having editorial options as the case may be, but having it match, having it be motivated, having all those things create, you know, you have shot structure, a scene structure, you know, why are we doing this shot? Does it need to move or not move, or does it need to be locked down? So there's a lot of other things that go into it just before you start setting the lights. I do love meters in the sense, and if I have a crew where I can be like, okay, you set up the camera, and then I can go work with the gaffers or whatever and start laying lights down where they need to go, I'm not thinking about what's on the monitor, I'm thinking about what the space is, and then I can create something within that, and we block it, and then we shoot it. So it's a mixture of all of these pieces that you're constantly going through as you sort of look at whatever you get at the time, which is always different.
That's good advice. How about you, Jim?
So the question is...
The question, well, I asked like four questions. I'll sum them up.
It's not about going from operator to...
Yeah, so like my first question was kind of like, you know, kind of what is that distinction from you of going from operator to DP? And then we kind of segued into the role of lighting and that role of a DP.
Yeah. When Matt was talking about what he was saying about that, I think what came in my mind was after the years I've been at this, that now I'm able to sort of look at the bigger picture more. Like you walk into whatever situation it is, whether it's a room or out in the middle of a desert or where, and you're just trying to take all of your skill set that you've, you know, accumulated over the years, and it essentially comes down to more boring things like problem solving and management. And so I could go, I want to have a lot of control over like lighting per se, and I'll have a crew that is responding to my needs directly versus somebody like some of my regular gaffers. We sort of know how we work, and I can sort of not pay attention to that for a while. But then I come back and review, make sure it's within my parameters of what we're trying to, the problem we're trying to solve, because they may not know the big picture stuff. They just want to make it look nice, but I go, okay, but it needs to go in this direction. And the other thing that happens with me is I work with a lot of crews and I travel a lot. Sometimes I'm with crews that don't speak any English. Now, as I'm dealing with a lot of people where I'm trying to coordinate my style or what the client's needs are with pretty much any tool that comes my way, whether the tool is a camera or a truck full of lights or a crew or whatever the tool is or whatever the resource is, coordinating it. So it becomes more of a management thing, but a creative management thing, you know? So so sometimes more control is needed. Sometimes it's like, I got enough to do, so I have to delegate, or else it just won't be fun. So I think that's the difference from earlier on, where I was maybe trying to control more, and I was a little more nervous about my skill set or pleasing clients. I mean, and it can vary between whether you're on your own on a small shoot or you've got a whole tent full of clients watching and scrutinizing. You gotta know how to manage all that. So,
I
was gonna kind of one anecdote about kind of where I got my explanation for the difference between camera. So, about 7 years ago, when I was a producer at the Postal Service, so I was really just at the start of my career. One of the first big jobs I was given. Big budget and high expectations, and it was kind of like, you know, they throw you in the water without anything to say, you know, try and get back to land and swim. I hired Jim to shoot a project for me, and it was pretty much one of my first things I produced and directed at really high level out of grad school. And one of the things I appreciated immediately was Jim's ability to, I had an idea of what I needed, but not all the pieces.
Translate that vision.
Jim was able to suggest things that I couldn't have thought of on my own, even though I had meticulously planned the look of how it was going to, you know, kind of come together in post and what I needed. But Jim was, that was the difference when we were on set, is I somehow got out what I needed, but you were able to give me options that I didn't think of. And I think that's what worked. And that's why, you know, and I was so early career at that point that that's what I really appreciated, was the ability to watch you think and analyze the situation. And so that's translated, and I try and translate a lot of that thinking to my own work.
I wanted to add one last thing that's along those lines, Matt. I think one of the things that I noticed in my own evolution over time was when you finally get comfortable enough with the technical, it makes it easier, like Jim is saying, to step back and see more big picture. And I think one of the crucial things, especially in the documentary world, when you're not doing narrative scripted television, is trust. Yeah. And I think, you know, you can get lost in the reeds talking about the technical and the lighting and the framing and all of those, but you are having an impact, whether you like it or not, on whatever it is you're documenting. And so I think a really important thing is just the life skills of taking the time to let the people that are being generous enough to let you capture their image. Mm-hmm. They're giving you something. They're letting you into their lives. They're sharing a big part of their soul with you. So I think a big important thing to always be cognizant of is that they are giving you that gift.
Yeah.
And never take it for granted, and show them the respect and dignity that they deserve.
That's a great point.
And it makes you a better photographer.
So I have two last questions, then we'll open it up to the floor, because I'm sure a lot of people have very burning questions, probably technical and creative. You know, one of the things that I face in my world all the time is the look, right? The feel. We want it to be like this, right? And I spend a lot of my time keeping my skills sharp by emulating looks, figuring out how a look was done and that kind of stuff. How do you guys stay sharp creatively with what you do? As you all have said, hey, every situation's different, every project's demands are different, but how do you kind of keep pushing, I guess, the creative envelope when you go to a project and not get stuck in kind of, okay, fine, I set this light here, I set this light here, and that's that. What do you think?
I mean, my immediate answer is work with other creative people. And I try and work with other people who I consider to be smarter than me or are skilled in a different area that I'm not quite as skilled at. So that's why I work with Peter a lot. And I love working with Peter. Sometimes I've been in a directorial capacity with Peter. Other times I've been a B camera operator to Peter when he's DPing.
Interesting.
And so we've worked together in many capacities. And every time we work together, I always learn something new and see something. And we always problem solve in different ways. You know, if I'm directing, where, you know, he's providing me, you know, thoughts about this, or, you know, script issues, or how to solve a problem to get over what we need to do in a time allotted. And other times, if I'm B camera, he's giving direction, and I'm, you know, giving him options that he might not have thought of. So I think working with other creative people is the absolute best way to keep your skill set sharp and learn something new.
Now, Peter, he called you out. He's, it seems like a very good compliment to me.
Yes, sure. Thank you,
Matt. How do you approach this? Like, how do you stay sharp, pushing the kind of creative boundaries, staying relevant with the looks and the feel that you're developing? How do you test yourself that way?
It's a couple things. I mean, I think working and having good people surrounding you always with a team is great. I mean, it's invaluable, and there's plenty of times when, of course, you just don't have, you're in the middle of something and you don't have the perspective, and having someone around you who can be like, well, let's just shift it over here and do it, because you've just done 20 shots and you're like, absolutely, like, perfect, let's mm-hmm. do that over there. Mm-hmm. And have that open communication all the time with all of your, both your clients and your crew and everything else. I don't know, I always try to go back to theory a little bit and like read things every once in a while, because you kind of like learn something and then you forget it, and then you come back to me like, oh yeah, that's awesome. And then personal projects, because at least for me, I'm flanked by two incredibly talented people, but I also didn't necessarily come up in the same ways that they did, and so I'm always looking for personal projects and things. If I have downtime, in addition to when I'm not with my children, I am looking for, I'll happily shoot someone's student project, just because I get a lot out of
it's
that.
It's a break from the day-to-day.
It's a break, and it changes things. And it also, and if it, even if it's just photography or going to the museum or having a conversation, a lot of times, like, it just kind of sparks something different. And so that's, and of course the technology forces you to constantly be learning. But
I mean,
go ahead.
I was just going to say, when I came up, the music video was the greatest.
Yeah, that's right, exactly.
The more you screw it up, the more they love it.
Right,
exactly. You know, and you learn from making mistakes, and you Dutch try angles, things you'd never try. And I learned, I was doing Steadicam on one where Eastern European DP, very talented guy, and he took a little pepper and he threw some party gels in front of it, and in the middle of a take, he would open the door and flash the film, you know, in little moments, doing everything your whole career you were taught not to do.
Right. Yeah.
So that, I was going to say, and the other thing is that I completely agree that working with other folks that bring something to it. I mean, at one point I felt like I was starting to get into a rut because I was doing more corporate stuff than I'd like and a little less creative stuff. And you have clients that are so afraid of pushing any boundaries whatsoever that you take the time to set an edge light in the exact optimal spot to get just the right amount of wrap, and you have it just the right height so you don't get a shadow from the shoulder, and it doesn't hit the orbit of the eye because it's not too high, and you color correct it just where you want it.
It becomes more mechanical than being creative.
The client starts saying, isn't that a little hard? And they start backing it off, backing it off. They're so afraid of actually making a decision on their image. And then I was doing a spot around that same time with Stu Stack, a fantastic lighting guy and just a stellar human being that owned a Sirius Group and Electric up in Baltimore. And we're doing a spot on film, and I guess I had gotten beaten up by a lot of people that were afraid of taking any chances. He's like, dude, you're shooting film, you know, like have some fun with it.
Right.
And he just started killing my subject and all of a sudden I started lighting higher key, not trying to make the light seem like some inadvertent little...
But make it purposeful in the scene, yeah.
Very purposeful. Yep. You got lights, use them and you know, get a key side edge going, get a fill side edge going, and make them deliberate. Make it a choice on set, we want that light that hard. And you start taking more risks and it helps.
Cool. Kevin, what do you think?
Well, I have clients, you know, I have a lot of clients who are very rigid. I mean, they've become trained to have an expectation of what it looks like, how big it is, where the keys are, where the backlights are, how much space it requires, how much it costs to get it on an airplane. But I do have two or three clients that allow me to once in a while think outside the box, even on the most simple thing. And that means maybe I'll light it a little bit differently or I'll take a different approach that I don't normally do. And I think the original question was what keeps you sharp.
Yeah.
That's one of the things. And I think I force the issue sometimes and I'm like, no, I'm gonna do a bounce light for a key this time, you know, just for shits and giggles. Oh, sorry, shoots and giggles. But the other thing I do is in my free time, I play. Like I experiment with different diffusions.
And you guys
have
all said that, right? I'm sure like you have little like, you know, setups at home where you're constantly trying out new lights and new techniques and stuff, yeah?
Yeah, no, all the time. I mean, my wife thinks I'm a freaking maniac when I'm constantly staring at my arm, you know. But who cares?
Yeah.
A couple things as far as skills, keeping yourself sharp. Be a sponge, right? I mean, I'm like, as much as you can do to absorb other people's work, you know, it's easy, right? Just go see a lot of movies and watch a lot of TV. Yeah, or if you have a particular topic coming up, a project coming up that maybe requires some research, some visual research focused on that. So that's the easy part, just watch a lot of movies. And hopefully that stuff, because when you're tired and you're busy and you're just don't have a lot of time to, you know, contemplate things in a nice, relaxed fashion, hopefully that kind of stuff will be ingrained a little bit or intuitive. And this means the other part too is just shoot a lot, just do it a lot, whether it's a personal project or just work. I find when I have lots of time off, like I had a break at the end of the year, beginning of this year, and then that first job back, and I'm like, and I walked into a room, like, you know, it was the first day of some shoot, and I'm like, my head is not working. You know, usually if I've been shooting, I can go bep, but this is what I want to do. But that day I was like, wait a minute. I'm a little rusty. So it's like anything, right?
The more times
you have to build and take apart and clean your rifle and put it back, so when everybody's shooting at you later, you're just like, I don't know what to do. It's like that. Just lots of practice, lots of shooting, and being a sponge. And I try to distill it to that simple kind of thing. The experimentation part of it. Yeah, sure. When I can, I try to be led by whatever the intuition or the look one. I don't know. I look for those opportunities. I can't say when they actually happen, but whether I light it this way or that way or how I play. I mean, it's like I'm always looking for those opportunities. And it's the same reason that I don't really own a camera, because I like the idea that I can kind of walk up to whatever tool is required, whether it's a big lighting truck or a few things or a red or something, and hopefully I can solve the problem with that. So that's practice too, knowing what all the different cameras are doing and what other people are doing with the gear. So
Very cool. Well, I'm sure we could go on because I've got a thousand more questions, but I think our audience probably also has quite a few questions. So we got about 15 minutes or so for some questions. Let's start with our first question there in the back. And speak up so everybody can hear you. Yeah, let me reinterpret that question. Do you guys have, what are those relationships like with producers and directors? Do you have favorites that you work with, people that hire you their own time, and kind of like, how does that back and forth work creatively? Are you getting direction from them? Do people trust you? Or is it a little bit of a mix of everything? What do you think, Peter?
It's different every time, and it's always a sort of like, Dennis just said something, it's life skills. It's having conversations with people.
Yeah.
The more prep you have on every job, the better the job's going to be. There's always going to be that. And the more conversations you have, the better it's going to be. I always try to just be as open and ask questions and hope that they ask the questions to me and provide all that stuff. I don't have a set, like, and here's your questionnaire for the shoot and all that sort of stuff. It's really very, I'm kind of an ADHD kind of a person or whatever. I'm all over the place, but when it comes to having a conversation, that's where I listen, and I provide. I try to find references for things, or I ask what people's references are. What are you looking for? What's your visual reference for it? Do you have a style or a mood or a whatever? And then I try to make sure that that's actually what it is, because a lot of times, like, someone describes something and it's not what you think it is. So it's a bunch of different things, but it's really honestly just like caring about what they're talking about, from my perspective. That's really the most important part.
What do you think down there, Matt?
I was going to say that there are certain producers and directors I work with a lot, and we tend to have a really collaborative relationship in terms of, they'll give me ideas, I'll give them ideas. Sometimes we meet in the middle, other times I'll just kind of go with the flow, or, other times they just say, Matt, we trust you, go and do your thing. So again, it really changes for every situation. I definitely like a little bit of collaboration back and forth, and especially when, and my always thought in my head is what's the ultimate client? Are they going to be satisfied with it? I try not to get too married to my projects. And that's just a thing. I try and be invested on the time that I'm there and the time that I'm on set and do the thing and be 110% focused. But I've gotten to the point where, if something doesn't turn out perfect, it's okay. And I'm okay with, if something gets, ruined in the edit, or it doesn't come out, the way you thought it was going to turn out, you know what? That's life. And you just say, yeah, you get it on the next one. So, even my own projects that I've shot and edited, and I've said, this is fantastic. And then, it's gone through several client revisions and it's not what I would have done, even from a DP side and an editorial side. And so you just be like, you deliver it and you move on.
Well, anything to add to that, guys? No?
I think it also depends on who you're working with. I've worked, certain people will see something else that I've shot and they'll say, I want that. I just want that. Other people, they actually want to sit down, have a meeting, take notes, get there, have a meeting, take notes. It just depends on who you're working
with.
I think certain people, they're married to their idea.
Yeah. There are times where I'm working with people and you just know it's a yes sir situation.
Right, whatever you'd like, sir.
Whatever you like, they say jump, I say how high. And that's fine. And sometimes I've done some of my better work occasionally where I've done exactly what they've told me to do. But then there have been other times where I've been given, complete creative control, and they come back with something, then it's like, we had no idea you were going to give us this. And at that point, I'm usually scared what the next reaction, but they're like, but it's great. Okay, good.
Gotcha. I think there was a question up front here. Yeah.
I had a question. Do any of you ever get, occasionally I get this happen to me,
where a client comes in and the director comes in and they've looked at your reel, they like it, they love your reel, but they want something completely different than what you do. And you're out on set and you don't find this out until you're out on set, and they're telling you exactly how to shoot something, like use this lens, do this and do this and do this, and they're the director, and you're thinking to yourself, you looked at my reel, why am I here? Does that make sense? Like you're just like,
that's a yes sir situation for me.
What do you do? Like, I mean, you just work through. I would just work through it.
That's all you can do. They're paying the bill. But right. I think the short answer is that the optimal is when you're truly collaborating. So yeah. It ends up being something in between. And we've all worked in both contexts. I had one guy I went around the world with, shot in maybe 25 different countries, all in Super 16 for PBS on this documentary. We would get to a scene, and his directing was, you know what to do. That
right.
was it.
I get that. Yeah.
End, well, that's good. No more input.
Yep.
Is that because you built up over the time that you spent with him? You built up that trust, and he kind of knew that.
He knew I would give him coverage. He knew right. he wouldn't yeah. have to say, "Make sure you get me some wide right. shots. Right. Make sure you get me some inserts." You know, he knows that I understand the mechanics
yeah.
and what he's going to need, so he's not going to come up short. Other people micromanage you. There's somebody in this room, Jose, working me with this crazy, I got to be careful about talking about him, but, you know, literally like calling the little cutaways that you were going to get anyway that any first-year film student was going to get.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I could let ego get in the way and say, listen, Bonehead, I've been doing this since before
right,
you
right.
had graduated elementary school, but that won't get you the next gig. Right. So you say, yes, sir, just like what Matt
yeah.
said.
Yeah, I was going to say, I typically make a suggestion. If I feel strongly about something, I'll typically make that suggestion twice. And if it goes ignored twice, then at that point, it's whatever you want. Yeah. That's my cutoff point. You know, any more than that, then I think you walk the line of being insubordinate.
Being
the dead
horse.
Yeah, exactly. And at the point, you're just wasting time, and it's just better to just do it and move on than it is to make a big deal.
We got another one in the back there. Yep.
Yeah, this question is kind of for Matt.
Mm-hmm.
I know you said you, you edit a lot of the stuff you shoot.
Mm-hmm. No, actually, if you're using in Premiere, the Lumetri color that's built into it, so it's pretty much has all the LUTs built in for almost every camera. So it's got all the S-Log to 709, all the Arri, all the Canon. So it's all built in, so you can set it for an entire clip, or you can just set it for individual shots that you have in your timeline. So typically, if it's log, I'll just edit with it in log. Just because I know, since I've shot it, you know, what it's going to look like, and then I just color correct it at the end. And then I usually do some tweaking beyond that. But yeah, the editing programs have all those built in, and you can, if Canon or Arri have all those LUTs on their website, you can download them and you can import them into the program and just load them in, or if somebody else has created some looks, if you use... there's a couple of programs, you know, real quickly, you can generate your own LUTs and export them. So if you use one of those, what's like Film Looks or a couple of the other ones that they have, you can build and they just all import them. And it's great just because you can have consistency. So if you have those on a monitor on set, you know, and you've built your own LUT, you can have it on set and then you can send it to the editor. And in theory, it allows you to have a completely controlled workflow. So there's no discrepancy between what was shot and then what's done in post. Now, you have to understand the workflow and how to do that, but it is a lot easier from that perspective to get a consistent look over the entire workflow than it used to be.
Wow.
Kevin is actually cryogenically frozen.
Yeah.
He looks much older than he is.
Because I love Dennis and I work with him a lot. So, and I'm just saying it because, especially in my age range, and I'm saying it that way especially, you know, I'm at the very, I guess, beginning of my career in a way. And I'm always interested to learn about whether somebody looks at a limitation for a DP in a more technical aspect, in a more creative aspect, in a more social aspect, whether your limitations are whether, you know, how to work with people or how to work with your crew or how, what lens or what camera you're using, you know.
Sure.
What are your, what would you say your biggest limitations are as a DP?
Well, I'll let those guys, yeah, I'll let these guys dive into that, but I can just give you one kind of observation that I face in the grading room working with a lot of DPs, is that younger DPs all care about the technical details to the T, right? They want to talk about color science and LUTs and yada, yada, yada. I find, like, the more experienced DPs that I work with just kind of go, yeah, whatever, like, make it look nice. All that really ends up is what's on screen. So that's from my perspective, that's, I find that younger guys are more gear tech driven, and the older guys more experienced are more aesthetic look and feel driven. It's my perspective. But anyway,
I mean, I guess the idea is, right, if you were a painter, right, and you're trying to get to the essence of whatever your subject is, you want the paints, what gets mixed, what brush you're using, you want all that to be kind of secondary, so you can get to what really counts. So that requires that you master all of the tools and all the tech stuff and the craft, or at least have collaborators or resources around you that know the stuff that you don't know. So you can, in my opinion, do what you're paid for, which is deliver powerful content, effective storytelling, whatever. Unless, you know, it could be a commercial, might be a different thing, right? Then it's all about the image, but it's still content that the tech stuff is secondary. So from my personal perspective, what you just said is exactly right. I consider myself much less capable on the technical side, and I really try to not crowd my brain with too much of that and focus on the stuff, the place that I want to get to. Mm. And if I have to crunch down and read and test learn a new camera or figure out a lot, I will, but mostly I want to, get that stuff aside or use things I know or get people I know and get to what they're really paying me for is get that moment, get that thing, So I focus on that more.
Yeah, and the tech specs of the deliverable are not even my thing. I mean, that's what they need. So it doesn't matter to me whether it's 1080p, 720p, 4K, 2K. It doesn't really matter. 422, 444. That's not even what I care about. I mean, the reason I bought a C300 is because I thought it looked better than the other ones. That's why. But it's lower bit rate. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there is a certain degree too. I mean, I'm sure you guys have all experienced this. I know that most of you guys are also active on Twitter and Facebook and stuff like that. Uh-huh. I'm always shocked by, like, you go to, like, Red User and places like that. How much, like, vitriol there is about some of the technical stuff, right? There's like, you're right, you're wrong, and like, there's a lot of like,
It's all relevant. It's right. All important. You have to be aware of it.
Right.
You just got to prioritize. Just not. I mean, I'm not somebody that can, just be an expert on every aspect of it. I have to choose what's the most important thing when and what's
sure.
What has to take a back seat, and that it's just personal management, I guess.
One's hiring me because I know. A better color space.
Right. Sometimes they are. Sometimes, yeah. Sometimes I'm not that, but sometimes they're hiring me to push the button or, be present in another way in a techno. I mean, people definitely have those priorities. I try not to take those jobs if I can, but I want to have those skill sets.
Sure.
I do, but you have to prioritize.
I think just because you're asking like what's the limiter and what's the struggle, and I mean I think the job of the DP is to provide a conduit between someone who has an idea and speak with all the technical people. And if you don't have any technical people to talk to, well then it's you. And obviously
that's a great point.
Yeah.
You have to figure that stuff out. So I mean, like growing up, I was a drummer, and then I was in a performing arts program, and I had this like really aggressive guy who was like this director, and he would like pound me down because I was the drummer, and he was just like. Structure and discipline. And I sort of look at stuff.
Wasn't there a movie just recently about that?
Yeah.
Like,
were you in Whiplash?
Awesome. It's this thing about like jazz. Like, to become a great, competent jazz player, you're going crazy and you're doing all this wild stuff, but you first master all the structure, all the discipline, so that you can then riff off that stuff. Mm. It's knowing why you do the things.
And there's always a learning element to it, but ultimately, like, I think the reason that we're all sort of doing what we do is that we have intuition and we can listen to it and we can listen to people and we can find the solutions and the and whatever it is to the problem and then produce something. So you're sort of a technician, you're sort of an artist, you're sort of all these other things. And then, you know, everything else just kind of works its way out because you try and you work and you problem solve on you get a problem and you fix it. You get a problem and you fix it. And that's always the way it is.
Well, there's a technical aspect to it, but it's kind of like being a painter. It's knowing the right brush for the right stroke, the right paint, or the right canvas, you know, the right combination of things, sure. But at the end of the day, how does the painting look?
My perspective on that is that I'm a little bit more of a generalist because I do edit and I do motion graphics and occasionally I direct and produce. So I'm a little bit more of a generalist. So occasionally people come to me because I do know and have a lot of technical knowledge. And so occasionally, and I'm on sets a lot where the crew is small, and a lot of times I'm being the DIT. And, you know, I'm, you know, doing the audio occasionally, and which I don't
Jack
always,
of all trades, right?
Yeah, and you know, I don't like to, I mean, I love when I get to work with a sound guy or an AC. It's to me, it's like the greatest thing in the world because I don't have to focus on all those things. But, you know, in this market, I find that I do a lot of corporate work, and, you know, the budgets are small, so you have to work within what's given. So they come to me because they're like, okay, you can do this, 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 and this. But ultimately, it's like when I'm setting up audio, you know, the only thing, when I'm setting it all up and I can do it, but ultimately I'm thinking while I'm putting it all together, how does that shot look? Because that's my primary responsibility. You know, it just happens to be that this is just a sit-down interview and I can do the sound for that. But I would much prefer to have somebody worrying about that, and I find that when I have a sound guy in an interview situation, my interviews look better because it's one less thing.
You focus more.
Because if I have 2 hours to set up one thing, you know, as just setting up the camera and the lighting, but I have 2 hours to set up the camera, lighting, the audio, the backdrop, like every single thing related to it, that stuff starts to. I basically go for a standard setup because that's all I can do. But when I have time to really focus, then, but you know, that's the market that I find myself in, and I think that's I'm kind of a pragmatist, very practical about the way I look at things, and you just have to do within, you know, what the budget is and what the time is and what all the limitations are. So, you know, I would say, you know, limitations for me is that because I'm an early career DP, is I haven't had as many variety of jobs at this point. So that you can look at that as one of my limitations. Now, like I said, I'm early career, so those jobs will come in theory, but you know, there's a lot. So I can tell you the difference between my demo reel 3 years ago and my demo reel now, how much variety I've gotten in those 3 years.
Sure.
So, you know, those limitations as I see them are basically just things that I would look to branch out into.
Any other questions in the audience?
Yeah.
Sorry, right over here.
You talked earlier about photography and other things. I'd love to hear where these gentlemen get their inspiration, and no one's allowed to say deacons.
it's kind of what I was getting at a little bit earlier. How do you keep you guys, you know, self, you know, sharp? And obviously, I'm sure that there are DPs and films that you admire, and that, you know, and that kind of stuff. But that's a great question. You know, where do you draw kind of that, you know, like the Kevin Bradley look, the Jim Fall look? Like, where do you pull that level of inspiration from?
I call it modeling. It's one of those classic ways of figuring out how you're going to get your skill or what you admire. And it can be a aesthetic thing, but it can also be a working style. I've had three or four great mentors in my career. And actually, a quick story, one of them I got to work with this weekend. I hadn't seen him in 25 years.
Oh,
he actually invited me to a feature that he was directing and producing, and he had written and DPing. And I was a film loader when I saw him last, and he invited me down to operate. And it was great, right? And I remembered all the breaks and opportunities he gave me, but I modeled his work ethic back then, and I did now. And one of the things he said to me over the weekend, we were blowing up cars and making rain and all this stuff, is he did an effects shot out in this action sequence, and within a couple of hours, he stayed up all night and composited three plates.
Oh, wow.
It was like a guy breaking a
a car window and dragging the guy out, and we did it in the rain. He put this thing together in a couple of hours and showed it to me on his phone the next morning. I said, holy shit, how did you? And he's like, you have to keep reinventing yourself. He's an ASC DP, and he knows that he has to
learn new skills.
And I was like, and I can think of all the people, you know, not just movies and DPs I admire, but all the people that I had direct contact with over the years that taught me something or taught me a work ethic, and you know, try and remember that. I mean, that's my inspiration. I mean, there's a DP that owns the rental house here. His name is Arish. Arish is one of my mentors, and he taught me so many things. These days, he's subliminally trying to teach me simple.
Yeah, because
he's like, he'll say all this talk about cameras. He would just kind of blanch. He'd go,
even though he owns a rental house.
He'd go. I don't care. Follow the story. And you know, he does these big Davis Guggenheim documentaries. Yeah, right. And I go, what cameras do you use? And what are you doing? He's going, I don't know. Would you have lots of cameras around? We don't worry about it. We follow the story. And you know, they're Oscar nominated docs, right? So
yeah,
I go, I'll watch what he takes on jobs. He's doing some big thing on U.S. diplomacy now, where he's going to the U.N. and he's going to NATO meetings. And I look and say, hey, what are you taking with you? He's got a camera, two batteries, a zoom lens, and an A7S Mark II. And that's it. I go, no tripod, no nothing. He goes, no, I'll get it there if I need it. And the guy, shoots. I can't do that, but I'm gonna keep thinking. You know, so it's like that, modeling people. I take what I admire about them. It may not be everything, but I take what I need and I've tried to build it. Another guy has effortlessly transferred between features and docs for years. He's not just one thing. He gets sick and bored. So I go, how can I make my skill set, you know, translute, so when I go from one to the other, I can show up and function and fit in, you know, not have too much stuff, have just enough, or be able to do something with, you know, way more resources than I normally have. So, you know, I take what I can use from different people, and hopefully it's created this hole that is employable and so far. So
I feel the same way about you. I mean, 15 years ago, you were yelling at me and.
No.
I learned a lot from Jim. Jim taught me a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
I have a question. How much of all you're learning right now, how much still photography do you take? Because I just want to hear everybody just say it a lot. Do you still take still photography pictures?
I do, and I started with stills at the age of 14.
You still do it now?
I do.
And what about you?
I do, yeah.
And you?
Only for a viewfinder. I don't.
Never press the shutter.
Location scouting and picking frames for. It's amazing. I don't take still. I have all these cameras, but I just don't. I don't.
I mean, the last DSLR I had was the Canon 7D, but unfortunately, I had Rockstar hot rod cameras.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Basically, took the mirror out of it. So I couldn't use it as a camera anymore.
So, I have an IR camera that they did like that for me. Yeah. This was fun.
I take a lot. I mean, I use this a lot, you know.
What's the adage? The best camera is the one you have in your hand, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
I take a lot of still. And that's so what I do to unwind, especially when I go on vacation, is I'm not the kind of person who would likes to sit on a beach, or I have to be doing something. And for me, that's taking stills, because when I'm not, you know, in the video world, I want to be doing something. But you know, for me, taking still pictures on a vacation or something like that's how I unwind.
Yeah. Okay, last question I have is referencing 8K. Now, when I went out to a government video, they talked about doing 8K. Basically, you can edit it better on 4K when you take an 8K footage. What's happening with that? They're pushing the envelope for more and more K. How are you interpreting?
Well, the C500, the Canon C500 Mark II. In about 3 weeks, we'll be 8K.
This is
it will be an 8K camera.
It's largely being pushed for. I was speaking at a conference recently in Japan, and NHK in Japan has been the real predominant pusher of 8K resolution, along with Snell, which is now Quantel and Snell and that kind of thing. Red is obviously pushing into this, and the idea is, I think Peter mentioned this, kind of like the downsampled idea, right? So the idea is that, hey, if 4K is to 1080, 8K is to 4K, right? The idea that you're going to be shooting at, you know, something like an 8K frame size for 4K deliverables or UHD deliverables. So I think that makes a certain amount of sense. The processing workflows, especially in the non-compressed side of things, are just insane. You know, the system, like a base light running 8K base light where they're having demo modes, the drives that they use on those systems are minimum putting out 2,500 megs a second. For they're doing all DPX and OpenEXR 8K. 2,500 megs a second.
And how is 3D coming in, Bob? Do you have anybody seeing that technology happening? What are they doing with 3D? They're selling all these TVs in 3D.
Making people nauseous.
No, besides right. That, right? See, how are you looking at that from a video photography?
Have you guys ever shot any stereo?
That's one thing.
Yeah.
That's going away for me, but what's huge now in every shoot I'm on is VR. We have a VR crew with. I'm now having to plan on my normal shooting how to get the VR crew in there to get what they need.
Right.
And that's like, it seems like it took over from the 3D thing. I don't hear about it. It's like there's always a guy around with that stupid GoPro or thing, and I'm like, all right, we all have to leave now. Let's all go.
But at least that
behind the bush.
At least that's manageable. I mean, as opposed to operating like this.
Yeah, with a top bottom. The VR thing is interesting because I think that it also is providing people. I don't know. We're getting away from, like, especially on the post side of things. It's less about like grading pixels, and it's eventually becoming more about like grading like truly like light and manipulating depth and that kind of stuff, right? So like, do you know what a light field camera is? Like Lytro and these cameras. This is cameras that basically record the incoming light to the sensor, know exactly what angle it was, know exactly what the wavelengths of those lights are. So, like, for example, the guys at Lytro they're working on a system that's 4K light field. Imagine shooting something and then somebody who's wearing goggles can selectively focus on what they want, right? So, like
changing the depth of field.
Changing the depth of field as they're viewing the content. Right? Like, it just gets crazy to think about all the kind of creative possibilities there. And that's, I mean, I think I agree with Jim. I mean, that VR stuff is going to blow up.
And I think the 3D maybe faded a bit just because the post 3D process has become so good that nobody wants to carry. I mean, I have limited experience on my end of going into a field with a 3D camera. It was so limiting. Like, the camera, the minimum focus was 9 feet.
Yeah, we really got side-by-side rig or something.
Yeah, it was stupid.
Parallax was that far.
Yeah, so I think everybody knew or felt that it was limiting, you know, getting the story in the field. And then, I mean, I still go to a good number of 3D movies, but they've all been post.
Yeah,
they're all modern. And some are good, some are bad. It depends on how much you plan it. But and then in my world is like gone.
I think the 3D thing really faded when ESPN killed it.
Yeah.
You know, because that was the be all, the end all, was that it was going to be for sports, and they piloted their channel for I think less than a year, and
they had a couple of X Games.
Yeah, and now if you go into stores, they're pushing HDR televisions way, and like you don't see 3D being pushed.
And I think that's interesting because have you guys thought about HDR workflow? I mean, because especially on Alexa, Red, et cetera, you're capturing images with enough dynamic range already. So I don't know if you go into thinking about things like HDR, but I think that's the kind of the next phenomenon.
2020 comes in.
I'm on probably one out of every four or five projects, I'm at least being asked about HDR workflow. And that's what we alluded to earlier, the idea between more pixels versus better pixels.
Right.
Right? And HDR really does provide better pixels. The idea of seeing more dynamic range and how we see the world naturally, I mean, I think that's going to be a really exciting push.
I think the odd thing about VR, and I had a conversation with a director that I've been working with for about 2 years on a documentary that I hope will end soon, but it's a great process, but he was talking about a feature that he was writing and it was all going to be VR, and so talking about how to use that and how to actually make that a story and how to engage a person in that versus like the sort of element of like voyeur sightseeing that VR creates. So in that respect, I think there's sort of a weird element where we're, you know, with at least the 3D, you're still framing something, you're creating something, you're lighting that, and still using it in a traditional sense. The VR part of it's going to change the way you interact with storylines.
More like a video game than anything else,
Or open world type thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's where, like, you know, how do you, you know, our jobs are sort of tied to creative reality or stylized reality, but it's a particular very narrow reality, and to change that, and how do you
use that and interact with it for a story-driven piece is going to be an interesting leap.
I think 360-degree set design and things of that nature comes into play there. I mean, the idea that the camera... Sure. Mm-hmm.
It's got to be motivated, so...
The camera's not...
One last question. We got rid of time.
Cameras. Are you finding that on your shoots that you're actually having a lot more cameras that are set up at different areas and having a lot more cameras than you ever did, but they're not manned by anybody? And you have
GoPros.
I will if I have to, and that's part of the management process. I go... Sometimes it's like, okay, you're giving me these two PAs and they're going to operate cameras. So I go, okay, I got to really control these guys if they're not, you know, not cameramen. Or I have a bunch of cameras. This thing's only going to happen once. So you
document as best
you can. Just do it. Yeah. And it's great because, you know, you GoPros, you can sit there on your phone. Okay, that's good. I just did this shoot in Nepal where we were stuck on elephants. The whole day we could not get off the elephants and we had to shoot the whole shoot from elephants. So I put GoPros on guys' heads and I put
the elephant,
you know,
dolly. That's
and I and I sat there and I'm moving along and I got my camera, but I'm looking at, okay, GoPro 3, good, okay, the guy's climbing in the tree, okay, and then the signal will go away, okay, roll it before I lose the signal, and then it would come back later. Oh, okay. So it's like, and all these cameras have Wi-Fi in them now. Yeah. So it's easier to do that. So that's another tool that you're managing, because it's great. They're inexpensive enough, so get them in there.
Yeah, I did a shoot with the Make-A-Wish Foundation where we had to land on an aircraft carrier, then take off again. So we had to rig up a jet with like 15 GoPros order to actually shoot the project. Then I jumped out with my C300 and my Easy Rig and went to work. But those GoPros got left behind because they, you know...
Disposable cameras.
That was it. Yep.
Very cool.
Gone.
Well, guys, we are out of time. I want to give George a couple minutes to wrap up the meeting. But can we get a round of applause, please, for Dennis and Peter and Jim, Kevin and Matt? Very, really insightful stuff.